Tinker, tailor, soldier, sailor, podiatrist, plumber, midwife, vet. Just imagine you were a skilled worker in another country looking to move somewhere else right now. Why would you choose New Zealand? In most cases, we can't compete on wages. The cost of living is super high. So conditions with visa applications and residency pathways are critical. The government announced detail of its so-called immigration reset this week. And although business leaders are mostly happy, some analysts noted the reset looks more like a repackaging of our old immigration settings. I sat down at Parliament to go through the detail with Minister Kris Faafoi.
In the context of our economic recovery, how important is migration?
Oh, look, I think we're going to have to watch the flows in and out very carefully. I think they're just starting to merge in terms of what might happen. I think things are moving very slowly in terms of movement of people. We opened up working holiday visa applications about a month and a half ago. We've got about 8,000 applications in. We've approved 6,000, and we're starting to see a trickle of people come in.
So I think, how important is it, though?
Oh, it's extremely important. I think we've got to obviously have a critical amount of skills here, and the offer that we make and the tools that we give employers to be able to attract people here is extremely important.
OK, let's talk about some of the measures you've introduced this week. And you've introduced a green list, which opens up a path to residency for people who are highly skilled migrants. And it's a two-tiered system. So talk me through that decision. Why is it two-tiered?
Look, I think there's some skills that are extremely in demand, and then there's some skills, and there's been some debate about the likes of nursing, that are extremely in demand, but there's concern from sectors about making sure they can retain those workers in the roles that we would like them to come and do. And that's really important. I think making sure that, you know, for those extremely important roles in both tiers of those lists, giving certainty about if we're trying to attract people here, that when they come, they have certainty about being able to bring their families and lay roots down in New Zealand is extremely important.
So we've got a massive midwife shortage at the moment, and I'm sure you're aware of. Why are midwives in Category 2 but doctors are in Category 1, for example?
Similar. The feedback that we got from the sector about the likes of nurses and midwives is making sure that they stay in their roles. When people have open work visas, when they have residence, they can get into roles and leave. There's some evidence that when people come from offshore and get into nursing roles that they might leave a bit sooner if they get residence, and we want to make sure that we can meet the needs of the sector to make sure that they have nurses in those jobs. Again, I think the important thing is making sure that they do have the pathway to residence, which they will do. And again, I think in the nurses space, my understanding is in the past we've had a very narrow ability for types of nurses to be able to come into the country. Now we're kind of broadening that to 13 types of nurses. So I think we're doing all we can to make sure we can attract those kinds of workers here to New Zealand.
It's a tough balance though, isn't it? Because you have to attract people in these critical roles, be it nurses or midwives, but you also need to keep them in those roles. And you know, if you are to take a midwife, for example, looking to come to New Zealand, they apply under this green list program. That means once they arrive in New Zealand, they have to work for 2 years, and after 2 years, they can submit a residency application. Now, on current waiting times, that residency application could be 2 years.
I might push back on that, because at that stage we would have cleared about 192,000 people through the 2021 resident visa. So the people that have been here on temporary work visas while we've been in the COVID settings for the last couple of years will be done.
When will those be done?
We've earlier this week said that we've pushed that timeframe out by 6 months in order to give us a bit of space in terms of processing to be able to prioritise some of the likes of accredited employer work visas, so migrant workers and visitor visas into the country when we open up the borders. I've given them more time, but I've asked them to stick to the original timeframe of 80% of those visas done in 12 months. We've given them some leniency, but our expectation is that they stay to the original time.
So just to be 100% clear on that, and I know that with these different visas, things can get a bit confusing. So just to be 100% clear, you're talking about the 2021 resident visa. Now, this is what you introduced in September of last year. And at the time, you said 80% of applications would be processed within 12 months. Now, to be clear, will 80% of those applications be processed within 12 months?
Well, that's the aspiration. Earlier this week...
It's the aspiration, but you're seeing the numbers come in at the moment. Well, and the numbers aren't good. We've processed about 20%, right?
No, that's not right. I think we've got about 46,000 visas that have been kicked out the door. My understanding is that of about the 25,000 visas that we got through phase one and what we call phase 1.5, we've done about 20,000 of them. So we've actually got through most of the early stages of the residency visa program. The second stage opened up in March. That's using a different technology platform. We've got close to, I think, 90-ish thousand applications. And in the next couple of weeks, we're going to start pumping those applications out. So what we've said this week is the original timeframe, we're giving them 6 months more to do it. The commitment to those people to get residency doesn't wane, but we want to make sure we've got the processing capacity to do everything else that we've talked about
I'm
as well.
I'm just getting confused here. So when you say that you're throwing
simple.
It up by
it's
six
quite simple.
Months, okay, you said
we 80%, said 12 months, yep. 80% in 12 months. This week we said 80% in 18 months, but I want them to keep to as closely as possible to the original time frame.
You were pretty explicit about that 80% in 12 months target.
Yeah, but that was before we were opening the border and other visas need to be processed.
We could foresee a border opening, surely.
Did you know when it was going to open? We didn't know when it was open.
I knew they weren't going to be closed forever.
Yes, but we need to make sure that we're doing as much as we can to get those residency visas processed. And now we have to also make sure we can do in a timely way the likes of visitor visas so that when tourists want to come here, they can do that from non-visa waiver countries. But also the accredited employer work visa starts up on July the 4th.
Let's go back to those announcements. And you challenged me when I was imagining a midwife considering coming to New Zealand. So a midwife decides to come to New Zealand, comes in under the green list, works for 2 years. After 2 years, that midwife can apply for residency in
Correct.
New Zealand. At that point, with the information that you have available right now, how long do you expect that residency application will take to process?
Well, it should be quick. That was the point I was
making.
Like
a year
before.
Or...?
No, I don't think it should take a year. I think what the point I was making is the people on shore, a bulk of those, in 2 years' time after that person has arrived, would have been through the residency visa. The people who have gone streamlined would have had their visas already. So I can't give you an absolute time frame, but it'd be a lot quicker than what we had in the past.
All I'm trying to do is imagine this through the eyes of someone considering coming to New Zealand, because the truth is we can't compete on wages with the likes
of Canada. Most important thing that we can say to them now is that they're coming, whether it's straight to residence or a two-year work to residence, that you'll be eligible for residency when you get here.
You'll be eligible after 2 years to apply for residency.
That's right.
But what we can't tell them is how long it'll take, which means that if you, let me finish. For example, if you wanted to buy a house, if a midwife came to New Zealand and thought, I'm going to set up in New Zealand, I'm going to buy a house, they're looking at where to move at the moment, they say, right, Australia pays us better, Canada pays us better, but maybe New Zealand gives us a faster application when it comes to residency. And they say, well, actually, we can apply after 2 years, we don't know how long it'll take, we don't know when we could buy a home. It's hardly certainty, is it?
No, but what I'm saying is that in terms of the back office situation that we've got at the moment, the investment in technology and also the investment in resources, people, that we think we're going to be able to get the types of visa processing, which whether rightly or wrongly people have perceived to be a long time, will be much streamlined and smarter in the future. I think one of the issues that we've had with the likes of residency applications in the past is it's been paper-based, that will all move online. I think, one of the frustrations with us and also people who apply is that if something's not right in the application, you get a to and fro of the application. That won't happen now. If you don't have all the paperwork, you won't be able to submit the application online, so we don't get the delays that people have experienced in the past. So I think the technology changing from a paper-based system to an online system, I think, is going to make a big difference to the user experience.
Why July 31st?
Because that's the assessment. Well, originally, obviously, in February, we said October. Mm. We've been watching the border settings, whether it be health, whether it be as we stage our opening in terms of other visa holders, whether we have the capacity to process. And we obviously said back in February that we want to do that as soon as possible, so to be able to bring it to...
So why July 31st? Why not tomorrow?
Because we need to make sure that everything is ready. We need to make sure that if people are going to come to New Zealand, we've given time for the likes of airlines and airports to get ready. It's a complex dance to be able to try and get everything back to normal. It's easy to close the border. It's more difficult to open it.
So are airlines the reason that we're not bringing that data?
No, there are many factors.
What are the predominant factors?
Look, I think making sure that things are safe is obviously the important issue. We've obviously
Well, what's going to change between now and July 31st?
At the beginning of the year, when we did this, we hadn't quite got through the Omicron outbreak. We knew it was coming, and we wanted to make sure that if we opened the borders, that we could deal with that, and our health system could deal with that too. I think we're pretty confident that while we're not out of the worst of it, that our health system is geared to be able to deal with things.
So again, what's the difference between now and July 31st?
Well, Jack, I'm saying it's a number of factors. I said health is making sure the logistics are right. It's making sure we've got the visa processing right. We said October.
That's the one, though, isn't it? It's the visa processing.
Well, that's the one that I'm responsible for.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've still got to work through our regime for making sure we're vigilant about assessment of variants at the border as well. So when all of those things come together, we are confident that July 31st is the right time.
You've had 2 years to prepare for some point when we would open the borders. 2 years to prepare for this date. Shouldn't you be more organised?
I think we're extremely organised given the challenges that we've got. When the border was closed, our staff were still processing the likes of border exceptions, critical purpose visas. We let 30,000 people through to do critical work when the border was closed. Then we asked them to make 165,000 people back in September or October of last year residents. Then we assessed what was a movable date in terms of opening up our border. We've decided July 31st. We think we can manage all of those factors and get the visas processed in time. As I've said, I've been advised about making sure we can manage that resource, and I'll get grumpy if they don't.
You've done nothing to address the problem of split families. So can you explain to me, why can a tourist visit from England tomorrow, but families from many African or Asian countries who have been separated for the last 2.5 years have to wait until after July 31st?
We made a conscious decision that we actually announced in February about taking a staged approach. We talked about working holiday visas coming at first because we wanted to make sure that we did everything we can.
So why are split families at the very end of that list?
Well, they're not. Some have been
able to... Who comes after split families?
Well, if you're talking about families from non-visa waiver countries, that will be able to come in on the 31st.
Like India, for example. We have a lot of migrant Indian workers in New Zealand whose families have been separated.
That's one example.
So why are they at the very end?
Because they are part of the cohort that get to come in on July the 31st. We've also, when we opened up to visa waiver countries, we've been able to reunite families.
So why are they last?
It's the nature of opening a border.
How?
When we said that we'd open up to visa waiver countries, those families that needed that process to happen in order to reunite could reunite.
They can't. For families from, if you have a worker in New Zealand from India whose family's
which is a non-visa waiver country, right?
Exactly.
So if you're a visa waiver country.
So I'm asking you why? Yeah. So you've got visa waiver countries which are, you know, predominantly European, for example. But then you take a country like India, from which we have a lot of migrant workers, and you have families who've been split for two years.
This is the decision that we took in terms of taking a staged approach to reopening the border. There are lots of people, whether they have families or not, from non-visa waiver countries that haven't been able to enter and will be able to do that from July the 31st. I'm very sympathetic to those cases. We want to make sure that we can get them back together as soon as possible, which is why my preference was not October, but to do that as fast as possible. We're able to do that on July the 31st, but we also had to make sure we're doing that in a safe way.
So is it not safe to let in people from India at the moment?
No, but when we were taking our overall approach to reopening the border, we always wanted to make sure that we're doing that in a managed and safe way.
Wouldn't the kind thing to do be to say, OK, we're not letting in tourists from non-visa waiver countries right now, but if you have family and you've been separated for 2 years by this pandemic, letting in tourists from the UK...
I understand how difficult it is, and at many stages during the last 2 years, my preference would have been to do something else. But we've had to make decisions that put safety and safe reopening of the border at the heart of every decision we make. They're not easy decisions to make. My preference would be able, as a family person, to reunite those families. But some of those decisions had to be made for the greater good to keep people safe.
Hoki Mai, welcome back to Q&A. Immigration New Zealand has faced criticism for long delays in visa processing times, but Kris Faafoi is promising that's going to change.
Under the Level 2 border reopening earlier this year, you promised 20,000 critical workers would enter New Zealand. In order to qualify, they had to earn 1.5 times the median wage. So 3 months on, I think by the latest numbers, fewer than 500 have been approved of that 20,000, so 2.5%. By the end of March, 2 months after your announcement, just six had arrived. Where are the workers that you promised?
Well, this is what I was talking about before. The post-COVID people flow is a very interesting thing to watch. We gave that ability for people to come in at 1.5. We can't control what kind of jobs are available, but when the border was closed, this is the kind of thing that companies were asking for to make it easier for them to hire people. And again, this was at a point where there were still closed borders, Jack. So I think what we're seeing is that things are still in their very early stages, and while we'd like people to come here as fast as possible, I think you're starting to see the beginnings of people moving more freely, and we need to make sure that we meet demands of businesses who have had border closures. But, you know, it's early days in terms of the border opening.
In 2017, when Labor took office, a visitor visa took 21 days to process. Today, according to the Immigration New Zealand website, I checked this morning, 5 months. In 2017, an essential skills visa took 69 days to process. Now, according to the website, 5 months. Residency visas up to this point have been taking years in some cases to be processed. Why is it that under your watch, and with the borders closed, with very few migrants arriving in New Zealand, we've seen massive blowouts in the time it takes to process visas?
You've probably chosen the visas that aren't prioritised at the moment, Jack. The borders have been closed for 2 years. We haven't been letting visitors in, so visitor visas have not been a priority. The processing of any visitor visas are usually extensions of visitor visas of people who are already in the country.
Essential skills, 5 months.
We have made sure that we're extending those visas. Again, essential skills are usually of people who are already in the country while the borders are closed. And again, we've extended a lot of those visas. The visas to look at in terms of the processing capacity are the likes of the 30,000 critical purpose visas that we've let in over the last 2 years. Those critical workers that we had a bar and a threshold to let in, about 95% of those were done within 16 and 20 days. We've had border exceptions when we work with sectors like the primary sectors to bring in the likes of shearers or farm machinery workers or fishing crew. They are the ones that you should look at and the ones that we've actually been able to turn around.
Missing your own target by 6 months for the visa that you only introduced in September of last year, and were explicit about setting targets for
it
at the time.
And I've also said that we've done 46,000 between when they'd opened and now. And I think with phase two, you'll see those coming on board too.
Immigration New Zealand has 20% fewer staff than before the pandemic. Who's responsible for that?
We closed some offshore offices because that was becoming difficult. We didn't have control over whether those staff could work. But we've also, as I mentioned earlier in the interview, increased our staff here in New Zealand by 230, and probably will do more. We'll have to watch the flows of visas. I think you'll probably criticise me if I've hired too many staff and they're sitting around twiddling their thumbs. I don't think that's going to happen, but we're prepared and looking at doing that. I think, again, the important investment in technology to make sure that we move from what has been a paper-based system to an online system will make the user experience much different. There's been a lot of focus on timeframes. I'd ask that you look at the visas that have been actually being processed and prioritised over the last 2 years to make sure we can get people through the border while it has been closed.
Well, I mean, timeframes are the things that people who are considering moving to New Zealand are going to be looking at right now. Over the next 18 months, how many residency applications do you expect to approve?
Look, obviously, we're looking to do the remainder of the 2021 residency visas. So I think my simple maths is about another 150,000 to go for that.
And with the green list?
Individuals. Well, again, that comes down to how many people we can attract to the country.
But is it capped?
No, it's not capped.
If we had a quarter of a million applications, we'd accept them all?
Well, I'd love for that kind of demand for New Zealand, to live in New Zealand and feel that skills to be able to be a reality. But as I've said a couple of times, we're just starting to see the picture of what people movement is emerging at the moment. We need those skills. I think when we were at the Business New Zealand lunch the other day when we announced this, there's obviously a demand for businesses to get these skilled workers. Our job is to make sure that we give them the tools to enable to attract those workers here long term and make sure that we can give them the best possible tools to attract those workers.
Do you have a ballpark figure?
Look, again, I think it's difficult to understand what the flows in and out in the very early stages of borders reopening.
No word yet on the skilled migrant visa, or as viewers might know, the old point system.
Yeah.
Do you plan to introduce that?
Look, we're going to reintroduce it once the application window for the 2021 resident visa closes in July of this year, so I would expect in August and September that we'll be able to look at that. That's, again, if you think about the people who are going to apply for residency who are not on the green list and who are not in the RV, there'll be very few. We would have got through 190,000 people, so the demand from onshore will be very low. Again, it'll be a points-based system, we think, but whether or not we get the settings right with the green list and the RV and the new SMC, we're still sorting out.
Switch out immigration for a moment, put on justice. What's happening with hate speech laws?
Look, in the next couple of months, I think we'll have some more news. It's obviously a pretty complex area. I think we probably learnt a lesson when we put the discussion document out about just how fraught it can be. We want to make sure we get that right. We've got some advice from officials that we're still yet to take to my colleagues around the round table. But we're committed to making sure that we meet the recommendations of the Royal Commission. I think many of us have spent time down in Christchurch and know how serious it is for that community to make sure that we get those kinds of things right. And I think we'll be able to speak about that more in a couple of months.
Will those laws pass before the next election?
Well, I'm not going to preempt the conversation I have with my colleagues. So
what's your expectation, though?
Look, my expectation is that we can make sure that we keep our commitment to the Royal Commission. I don't want to preempt the decisions that Cabinet makes, but we'll take some options to them soon.
You're a busy minister, right? You are spinning a lot of plates. How have you found the balance of your portfolios this term?
Oh, I'm just a humble former journalist, Jack.
I know that no journalists, let alone telly journalists, are ever humble.
Look, it's busy, but I like it. The last couple of years in immigration have obviously been a challenge because at times when you want to use levers, they haven't been available. But I think it's heartening that we've been able to talk about the border reopening and get our immigration settings in place. Professionally and politically and policy-wise, it feels good to be able to get those big issues out the door. We've obviously made some announcements in broadcasting recently again that mean the kind of change that we've talked about in terms of the manifesto can be effected.
To the best of your knowledge, will you still be the Minister of Justice and the Minister of Immigration?
Ask my partner that. But obviously the Prime Minister's talked about things and that's up to her.
To the best of your knowledge?
Well, I'm not in charge of who gets which portfolios.
I know you're not. That's why I'm asking. To the best of your knowledge, will you have those portfolios in 6 months?
I serve at the pleasure of the Prime Minister.
Do you want to be holding those portfolios in 6 months?
I love the job that I've currently got. I serve at the pleasure of the Prime Minister.